Громадське презентує мажорний лад. Нахабна поведінка миколаївських молодиків шокувала всю Україну.
Слышь ти, с**а, свій телефон на очко засунь.
І як розслідування цієї резонансної справи практично сходить на нівець.
Чи пройшли вони медичне освідування? В матеріалах кримінального провадження, оскільки спершу воно досудове розслідування проводилось центральним відділом поліції, то в матеріалах кримінального провадження даних фактів немає.
Як скандальний олігарх наварив юшки на 70 мільйонів гривень?
Що можна подумати, коли сунув руку в воду, а вона горить, кип'яток?
Про масову загибель риби на Львівщині, за яку досі нікого не покарано.
Що хочуть, то вони собі творять.
Проєкт журналістських розслідувань «Слідство інфо». Дивіться в середу, 16 листопада о 20:30.
Good evening. Welcome to Romadsky International from our headquarters in Kiev. This is the Sunday show. We've got lots coming up. We're going to be explaining the geopolitical storm in Eastern Europe. My name is Tom Bell.
And I'm Tamara Rosevan. On today's program, we have a range of topics for you, particularly the consequences of the U.S. elections. Today, there are presidential elections in Moldova as well as Bulgaria, and the pro-Russian party is expected to sweep to power. We'll also be looking at Poland. They celebrated Independence Day this week, and we'll be looking at Polish-Ukrainian ties. And we'll examine Ukraine's defense sector reform as well.
Now you can download our podcast on Mixcloud anytime, the audio-only version, so you can download that. And also you can see full versions of all our interviews as well as our Russian and Ukrainian language content at our website, romadsky.ua. And if you want to watch this program in Ukrainian with a simultaneous translation, it's being provided from that website as well. We'll be back in a second. Now, the US presidential elections have dominated the headlines this week, and well, the world now faces 4 years of Donald Trump. His election has unnerved Ukraine and also Ukraine's allies in Eastern Europe. On several occasions, the outspoken Republican has called for America's role in NATO's missions abroad to be scaled back. And also, currently, the US has thousands of troops plus military equipment stationed in the Baltics.
Now, meanwhile, thousands of people from across the U.S. have taken to the streets to show their frustration with Donald Trump elected as the new U.S. president. These protests are largely peaceful, but some have resulted in blocked streets and bridges. There also have been several arrests made in different states. Reacting to the demonstrations, President-elect Trump has taken to social media and has posted two distinctly different tweets. So we'll be taking a look at those. As we see, the protesters are saying that they are completely not supporting Trump in a way. So that's the tweet that Trump has reacted with. He said, at first he said that these were professional protesters, but 9 hours later, it was a completely different tweet. He said love the fact that small groups of protesters have taken to the streets and have such great passion for our country. So we're coming together for our country, basically. Since the protests began across the U.S., Trump seems to be walking back from some of his campaign promises, including on Obamacare. Now he's thinking about leaving some of the key parts intact. Some of his priorities, he said during a recent interview, are healthcare, jobs, border controls, and tax reform. So these are some of the top priorities he has.
Now, I'm pleased to say, joining us in the studio is Romanski's own Natalia Gumenyuk, straight in from the United States. He just flown in today. It must have been an amazing 2 weeks. I mean, what was
the
highlight? 3 weeks,
Three weeks.
So what was the highlight for you?
Good evening, of course. It's very interesting. Just following up shortly, because I just kind of went to the plane from the protest in New York City. I feel it's kind of for the Ukrainians and the people in this part of the world important to understand that, you know, we used to protest when the elections are rigged. Mm-hmm. This is a very different thing. Everybody also in the streets of New York understand that, you know, Donald Trump, you can keep him accountable after his acceptance, which would be in January. So now it's more or less like the warning. We are watching out, you know, we are woken up, you should mention us. It's not like really just this kind of thing that we demand you to step down, nothing like that. I think it's somehow, that's what I feel sometimes, the Ukrainians or the Russians looking to New York protests and thinking like, oh, is it something like that? No, but I think that a couple of things to mention. These are about, in generally, how it was interesting for me, somebody from Ukraine, to follow the elections and, of course, foreign policy results. So picking up on the first, I've traveled to numbers of the states and, you know, later been in the campaign during the election 9 and Hillary Clinton headquarter, was not that surprised. After I spent some time in Ohio, in rural America, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia. And that's so interesting that this post-fact world was really there. Then you talk to an attorney in Ohio who had 40 years of experience in what he was doing, and he would challenge the rule of law, my biggest take is what I felt, this kind of nostalgia for the past, because I went there with exemption and a lot of people who have given me very valuable advice, an American journalist, well-experienced American journalist said, like, look, there is a differently this kind of the troubles, the economic troubles and the perils of the people in especially rural white America and also the towns.
And this is where he got his votes, wasn't it, in the end? I mean, the sort of the working class, uneducated people, this is where he triumphed.
That's the point, that you have this assumption that these are working class, uneducated people. A lot of these people may be uneducated, but not definitely poor. In Ohio, you have a lot of people and everywhere who are doing pretty fine. Their situation is not that bad. Maybe they feel worse than it is. And, you know, when you in particular ask, have you lost the job? The person would say, like, no, I don't, but
they feel like there's something better out there and that Trump can...
And Trump has obviously offered a lot of things, made a lot of promises. But obviously, the main question is, what does this mean for Eastern Europe, essentially?
So, of course, I think that this is this kind of thing that we can really relate, this nostalgia for the past, which is so much misused rather than real economic gravity, and something to discuss. With the foreign relations, so I'm coming not because of, like, I have my perspective, but I'm trying to reach out the people in Washington, D.C., both Democrats and the Republicans. So obviously we're waiting for the 3 months of the break. You know, like, nothing would be, because Democrats definitely have this kind of a smooth pass. They were really, when I was asking the members of the Democratic Party a couple of days prior to elections, what are you going to do if Trump wins? They would pause and would say, like, as if they were not thinking.
Right, but they weren't expecting.
No.
Essentially, the media almost made it sound like this was never going to happen.
So there are two things. The practicalities depends on whom Donald Trump would appoint on the key position on the State Department and the as the head of the as a defense secretary. And this is interesting. So definitely you have the part of the Republicans who like these transatlantic guys who are very strong, hawkish, strong on Russia, very knowledgeable. Mm. But they were not supporting Trump. That's the point. And I wonder if they are offended, you know, or he would appoint some of them. But definitely we'll look into Newt Gingrich as a possible head of the State Department. Newt Gingrich, during his short visit to Ukraine in September, talking to Hromadske,
yeah, we interviewed him.
You know, we interviewed him, said that he found the Baltic accession to NATO as something very, you know, like emotional. But this is a case. For instance, the Senator Bob Corker, who is very tough, for instance, the person on Russia, he could be the defense secretary. So the question is, would there be the kind of the guys who are isolationist or the really like hardcore Republicans?
Yeah, well, that's a very
this is the biggest question.
It's a very interesting question. And also we have a quote from Poroshenko. Is that
that's right. The election of Donald Trump has rattled Ukrainian government officials. Top officials are now to be working closely with Washington to secure a meeting between Poroshenko and President-elect Donald Trump earlier as early as next year. Ukrainian officials believe that bipartisan support for Ukraine will continue, and the Republican Party, which will now control control the U.S. Congress, has the backing of the Ukrainian diaspora, which is quite large in the United States, and they will be continuing lobbying support for Ukraine, and will continue to put pressure on Washington to continue a hard stance on Russia. This is according to Reuters. Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko in Kiev during a meeting with the U.S. ambassador to Ukraine had this to say.
Absolutely sure that will continue in the two very important spheres. In our fighting against Russian aggression, in our fighting for freedom, fighting for democracy, fighting for our sovereignty and territorial integrity, where the United States was and remain our reliable partner. And we also count on the continuation on the very strong support in our decisive steps in reform the country.
Now, after Trump's victory, there was one outspoken Russian MP who literally was popping the champagne. You can take a look at this video now. If you haven't heard of this man, his name is Vladimir Zhirinovsky. He was once described by Vice News as the clown prince of Russian politics and Russia's version of Donald Trump. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time on this program to go through all the outrageous things he said in the past. But by the looks of it, he looks like he celebrated well into the night.
He certainly looks happy. Now, France's far-right leader, Marine Le Pen, has also come out in support of US President-elect Donald Trump. Now, she had this to say during a press conference. Take a look.
Because only the interest of France and the French people count for me, I dare say here that the election of Donald Trump is a good piece of news for our country. The refusal of the transatlantic free trade area, and more generally of wild globalization, the pacification of the international relations, and especially with Russia, the withdrawal from aggressive operations that caused the big migratory waves of which we are direct victims, these commitments, if they are kept, are to France's benefit.
Very interesting. Now, Natalka, why do you think radical parties have become so popular across Europe, across US?
That's also something to follow, in particular with the Trump's election, which is a bigger concern. A lot of people, for instance, ask me about the connection of Trump to Vladimir Putin. But what is the most important is really the fact that there are a lot of values shared. And, the populism obviously growing. But what we have to watch out in this part of the world, you could have possibly hoax running the administration of the Donald Trump. But what definitely the leaders in this part of the world, in Eastern Europe, in Central Asia, elsewhere, in post-Soviet world, probably have the reason to celebrate, because they know at this capacity the White House wouldn't really talk on human rights, wouldn't really talk on freedom of speech, because if, I mean, you can't really imagine this, you know, Donald Trump speaking about, you know,
he wouldn't get involved, would he?
Any kind of the post-Soviet leader would never care about that. He would say like, whom? Donald Trump telling that we're doing something wrong here, or like, or he was speaking about the values of the freedom of speech. So in that way, it just go in line of the all radicals and populists, because this is more or less that the dominance of the United States on these issues, like which are very critical, which are issues like of the values we share, just wouldn't be there any longer. There is nobody but probably a couple of countries in the European Union, and that is probably would have a bigger impact rather than the direct relations to Vladimir Putin, which most probably would be really pragmatic in a way that we have him, Vladimir Putin, with Erdogan. Today we love each other. Today we think that we are strong guys. And now we have a quarrel. And then we really, you know, are again good friends. But we are already concerned for a couple of things. So, for instance, there is this famous Magnitsky Act. This is the bill which allows to, let's say, not to let into the United States the corrupt Russian officials, or not just Russian. And Vladimir Putin has already said that, you know, he would freeze some deal regarding over Iran, unless this kind of thing is not repelled.
Right. So foreign policy, it seems, is important for Europeans, you know, and for Ukrainian leaders, but it hasn't been dominant in the U.S. election as one of the issues that Donald Trump had like brought up. So we will have to be looking out for that, as well as the French elections, which will be happening next year.
And when you're in New York, actually, there were a couple of really interesting interviews that you filmed. One of them was with Jacob Weisberg. He's very well known in American political journalism circles. He's worked in the industry for years, and now he heads one of the companies behind online news sites like Slate and Foreign Policy. Let's take a look at this clip of your interview. It's really interesting. Thanks.
Trump has the instincts of a dictator and is a natural authoritarian. He is going to treat the press that's friendly to him one way and the press that is fair and honest another way. So you're going to have media that includes Breitbart, which, of course, his campaign manager ran, Fox News, the National Enquirer, which is a scandal sheet known for stories that aren't true, but whose owner is very close to Donald Trump. And I think you're going to see the pro-Trump media getting access, being favorable about Trump, and being liked by the administration. And then you're going to see the media that regards itself as objective and telling the truth, including the New York Times and the Washington Post, being pushed away. And I think this may put them more in the role of being a kind of opposition press, which is not a comfortable role for them. It's not the role they want, but I think they may have no other choice. I think we're very focused on not normalizing Trump. So not treating Trump as an ordinary president just because he is now president. We want to preserve our sense of the strangeness of it, of the outrage of it. And we don't want to just be preaching to the choir. We don't want to just be denouncing Trump and always telling people how terrible he is. But we want to tell the truth, and we want to focus on the reality of the Trump presidency. And I think for us, that means avoiding some of the conventions about objectivity, neutrality, about there being two sides of everything.
Somebody said, like, okay, it doesn't matter if we have Trump, the Congress would kind of stop him in some crazy ideas.
No, they won't. The Congress won't stop him. The Congress won't stop him. There will be pockets of resistance to Trump. I think some of the federal judiciary will resist him, obviously. The Federal Reserve, which is independent, will resist him. I think people in the military may resist him if he gives illegal orders like supporting torture or military action that violates international law. Those are places I would look for people to stand up to him. I would not look to Republicans in Congress to challenge him. They won't. They'll lay down and he'll roll over them.
What can we know? What can we speak at this stage in his Trump's
foreign relations.
Well, strangely, that Trump's foreign policy seems very much in tune with Vladimir Putin's foreign policy. Trump is not a supporter or an advocate of NATO. He's a critic of NATO. He is not an opponent of Russian intervention in Syria or in Crimea. And in fact, the one way that he asked to change the Republican platform was to remove the disapproval of the Russian invasion of Ukraine. So strangely, and it sounds so strange to say it, but I think he and Vladimir Putin are on the same wavelength. They have a mutual admiration society. What we don't know is how much they just happen to see things the same way and like each other from a distance, and how much there may have been an active collaboration going on. Because we do know that the Russians hacked the Democratic National Committee, that Trump was the beneficiary of them leaking that information through WikiLeaks. And so, you know, they're on the same side. It looks already like, as a billionaire, he is going to govern like an oligarch in the interests of other billionaires, not in the interests of his working class supporters. But in terms of the people who didn't support Trump, I think people are coming to grips with what it means now, how you can protest, how you can resist, what you can do. And I think people are trying to move from a feeling of despair and simply not being able to understand that the country's made this decision, to move from that to a feeling of being able to do something, either to prevent Trump from doing his worst or to start to undo some of the damage that he's likely to do.
Now, Donald Trump's victory is not the only major news story of this week. There are also elections in Moldova. Today, Moldovans have been going to the polls to elect a new president that's being watched closely in both Moscow and Brussels.
The elections saw this is the second round of elections, which in a contest that saw socialist candidate Igor Dodon narrowly miss winning a clean majority in an election held in late October. Dodon has been accused of being the Kremlin's candidate, while his opponent, former World Bank economist Maya Sandu, has advocated pro-European policies that have failed to gain fractions in the polls.
Now, you could be forgiven for not knowing so much about Moldovan politics. So we've made this graph, which you can see on the screen right now. So on the left, we have Igor Dodon. He's promised to revoke Moldova's stance within the association agreement, with the European Union. And also, he's leading in the polls. He's expected to win today. And on the right-hand side, you can see Maya Sandu. She's campaigned on a very much an anti-corruption platform. She spent 3 years as the education minister prior to her running for this election. But obviously, it's a lot more complicated than that. So we spoke to one expert, Maxim Edwards. He's an editor at the Open Democracy Russia. Take a look at this. You recently wrote an article for Open Democracy Russia, which was really interesting. We'll provide a link on our website to that article. And in it, you said that the pro-Russian candidate, Igor Dodon, he has said that now Crimea, which is officially Ukraine's territory under international law, he said it's actually de facto Russian territory. But at the same time, he's arguing for Moldovans to get a visa-free regime with the European Union. So where does he stand? Is he going for the popular vote?
Well, one of the issues with that I've been hearing when I've been speaking with analysts across in Moldova over the past week, a bit more, was that so when it comes to their electoral performance in the second round of Moldovan elections, Dodon is essentially appealing to a very, very, very pro-Russian electorate, and he's a very well-defined candidate. People have known him. He's been in Moldovan politics for a long time. People know him as the Kremlin's man, and he has a very kind of clearly defined political personality, in contrast to Maya Sandu. One of the issues with what that will represent in the second round is that there's a large group of centrist voters that probably many of them disaffected, who it will be quite, I think, difficult to win them over with that kind of rhetoric. I mean, Dodon's statements on Crimea, he did admit that it was a de facto Russian territory, but he did prevaricate quite a lot. I mean, Sandu was a lot more, let's say, blunt about it. She said that it is in contravention of all international laws. A big issue here is Transnistria, which is a breakaway territory which is de facto independent, and de jure Moldovan, which is significant Russian military and economic support. Dodon proposes a federalization of Moldova to resolve the conflict in Transnistria. So there are also some parallels here, which I think particularly could work against him. I think Dodon, as the Kremlin's man, is, in terms of the statements he makes, very, very overt. I mean, you know, he's declared that he will fight against LGBT rights in Moldova. One of his campaign promises was that he would defend orthodoxy. But I feel that I felt at least until the American election that he had understood that there was some work to be done in winning over those who were not that 30% of the Moldovan electorate, which are, highly pro-Russian and know where they stand on those issues. For example, some of his campaign literature, I have from Chisinau, is fascinating in this respect because it tells you a lot about Moldova's economic realities, which are very hard. You know, it's widely referred to as the poorest country in Europe in Western European media. One of them is his promises was that he would try and fully remove limits on the stay of Moldovan migrant workers in Russia, mm-hmm. unless they were linked with administrative or criminal detention, criminal cases. So you can see that although Russia... migrant workers from Moldova, remittances comprise around a quarter of the entire GNP. So in that sense, I think it's going to be a difficult line for him to walk to argue for both keeping the visa-free agreement and bringing Moldova into the customs union.
And Max, you've been to Moldova several times for a short visit. And from the people that you spoke to there, was there disillusionment with the political establishment?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, the government, the country has seen successive pro-European governments, many of which, I mean, I think one thing that really needs to be pointed out here is when it comes to Plahotniuc and his role in Moldova and how people understand it, one thing which young Moldovans who are more active in politics said to me was that you know, we protest oligarchy. It doesn't necessarily make us pro-Russian. I mean, the fact that there are pro-European governments who are partly kind of very strongly influenced by somebody who is not pro-European, not pro-Russian, but pro-Plahotniuc, puts people in a very difficult place if they really want to kind of try and change the structure, the oligarchy-ridden structure of Moldovan politics.
And also, Maxime, I have a question for you about Moldova's significance on the international stage as well, because unless you're into Eastern European politics, it's unlikely that you would have studied the intricacies of the Moldovan elections. So why are they important?
Well, I mean... a short answer is they're more symbolically important than practically. I mean, an important fact is that Moldova is a parliamentary republic. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons why we're having presidential elections, or we're seeing presidential elections in Moldova, is because it was one of the demands that was made by protesters. It was one of the things that some of them wanted to see when Plahotniuc's candidate as PM was nominated, Pavel Filip, who's remains quite unpopular. I think it was a gesture to that protest movement. I strongly suspect that the real question here is who's going to suit Plahotniuc more. And many people believe that actually Dodon, although he makes a lot of pro-Russian statements and pro-Russian noise, could be the more practical one for Moldova's leading oligarch, because he doesn't have the same history of kind of anti-corruption campaigning as Sandu does. And they could easily find some kind of agreement.
Uh- So it seems that the pro-Russian candidate is a more practical choice for the Moldovan oligarch Vlad Plahotniuc. These elections are a highlight of the government's tough balancing act between Brussels and Russia.
But what exactly do people want? Well, we have a graph for you that we've found. It's from the United Nations. We can show it on our screen now. So it's a survey on what Moldovans really want. We'll show it in a second for you. But here we go. Yep, so decent jobs tops the list, followed closely by better pensions and social allowances, a reliable judicial system, a quality healthcare, and more transparent government at a local level. So really, it's the sort of stuff that most people would like in any country, but this certainly like tops the list in this particular poll.
Yeah, the final elections will be coming in a little bit later, but so far, according to the polls, the pro-Russian candidate is expected to win. And but first, we're joined by a freelance journalist, Dan Palishuk, to find out what he's seen and heard in Moldova. Yeah. Welcome.
Dan, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
So you've written extensively about Moldova and especially the elections that are happening now. So what kind of changes will we be seeing if Mr. Dodon wins?
Well, the long and the short of it is that we don't really know quite yet. It's not the most satisfactory response, but it's true. I mean, he's been hoisted as sort of the pro-Russian candidate in this kind of grand geopolitical rivalry between the West and Moscow. And he certainly made many overtures toward that fact. I mean, he said that he wants to scrap the association agreement with the European Union. He said that he wants Moldova to join the Eurasian Customs Union. But he's also in the past weeks, I mean, he's made some kind of conciliatory remarks. He's still kind of sticking to that platform, but he's also, there have been an instance or two where he's kind of walked back on that, saying, you know, listen, I'm not in favor of sort of playing the divisive politics. What I really want is to provide, as we've just seen, you know, good jobs for Moldovans, a strong economy, and so on and so forth. But I do think that he'll probably he'll seek to kind of stick to his platform. But then again, we have to keep in mind that that the presidency of Moldova at this point is very symbolic. It's not very powerful. So even if he wanted to, he couldn't necessarily, you know, scrap the association agreement with the European Union tomorrow or the next day or the next year even.
Yeah.
So.
And it's actually the first time that Moldovans have voted for their president in 16 years.
Yeah.
So what sort of change will this bring? Why the change now?
Well, I mean, that's part of the reason why these elections are so symbolic. In that, it's really the first time that Moldovans have come out to vote. It's essentially a referendum on the politics of the past couple of years. It's the first election really since months and months of after months and months of political, social, economic turmoil. This gigantic banking scandal that absolutely tore the country apart. There's a politically, socially, and economically, of course. Mm. So this election, while not really kind of providing much power to the presidency, is really a referendum, kind of the people's voice, if you will,
yeah,
on how displeased they are. And of course, it also sets the tone, most importantly, for parliamentary elections in I think 2 years.
Yeah.
In 2018. So that's this.
And that's the real event, isn't it?
That is the real event. Yeah, that is a real event, especially because all the power basically rests in the parliament and the government. So really, this is kind of this sort of sets the tone, the political landscape, if you will, for the parliamentary elections.
So there's also elections in Bulgaria today. Again, the pro-Russian candidate is expected to win. So the question is, how will the European Union respond?
Yeah.
So we'll have to wait and see.
Yeah, exactly.
Of course, with all this news, it's easy to see the negative picture of a country. So we asked former Moldova ambassador to the UN what the country has to offer. So take a look.
Apart from the political corruption that's going on, that's very well known, what does Moldova have to offer to international investors, to tourists, this sort of thing?
Moldova is a traditional producer of good wine, so sorry for saying this, because we are always speaking about wine, but besides this, we have a lot of young people who are working for different IT companies, transnational IT companies, producing a good new technologies products here in Moldova. We are also the country who were able to solve the very acute inter-ethnic conflict, and here I speak about the Gagauzia, which is a region at the south of Moldova where the Gagauz people live, and we avoided the military clashes there, and we offered to these people an autonomy, and this autonomy was given as a good example of resolving such a conflict at different forums in Europe. So we are a country with a rich history, rich culture, and we could serve. I don't like this expression to be a bridge, because there are a lot of bridges now in the whole world, but we can indeed be a kind of a connection point between the East and the West. Moldova, unfortunately, today is a place where the Occident or the West is fighting the East, and we're a kind of battlefield of this. But we should be a place where the East and West meet and cooperate, and we have everything for this.
Now, the past week, Poland, Ukraine's neighbor, ally, and leading trading partner within Eastern Europe, has celebrated 98 years of independence. Over the last decades, Polish-Ukrainian relations have been at an all-time high. There's been a lot of bilateral business that's been going on, also academic exchanges and technological innovation. But first of all, let's take a look at what's been going on this week.
So on November 11th, Poland marked Independence Day. Now, it's usually celebrated with parades, events, concerts, all kinds of things. But over the past few years, there have also been when the country's nationalist and liberal movements held rallies and marches to mark the anniversary.
Yeah, and as you can see from the pictures we were just showing on the screen, tens of thousands of people took to the streets, including far-right nationalists. Also, thousands flocked to another march as well that was organized by a liberal movement in the capital's center. And many of those participants, you can't quite see it in this video, but there were young people, but also many families as well, families with children who waved flags with Poland's national colors, the red and white.
Now, Independence Day is obviously a very important day for Poland. After the First World War, the country regained its independence for the first time in over 120 years of foreign rule.
And we have an interview with the editor of Business Ukraine magazine. His name is Peter Dickinson. He's also an historian as well. So you can take a look at this now.
Peter, thank you very much for joining us on Romanski International.
Pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
So in the news this week, we saw a video of these nationalist protests in Poland. Happens every year. Lots of people, flares. It's a big deal. But in your opinion, what sort of nationalist sentiment is there in Poland, and what sort of historical factors play into this?
Well, I think that the Polish national identity has always been a very strong issue that has been aggravated or strengthened perhaps by the pressures coming from outside. From historically, it's generally been Germany and Russia on both sides. I think what's interesting about the current situation in Poland, where we have quite a right-wing a government that feeds nationalist sentiment, is that the support is coming a lot from the youth. Whereas, as we saw with the Trump election, for example, young voters tended to be much more towards the liberal, globalist positions, whereas in Poland, actually, it's the youth who are much more supportive of the nationalist stance, and the opposition to this government is coming from more middle-aged people, those who remember perhaps the Soviet past and have memories of the early 1990s stronger, whereas the young people are not falling in line with this.
That's kind of surprising. Actually, usually you expect it to be the other way around, where you'd have the elderly people who would remember the Soviet Union, perhaps the good parts of it, and the youth would be more progressive.
Well, as Churchill said, if you're not a socialist when you're 20, you've got no heart. And if you're not a conservative when you're 40, you've got no brain. I think there's an element of truth in that across the board, that as a rule, young people tend to be more in line with the tenets of us, which we could broadly call politically correct tenets, in terms of liberalism, in terms of globalism, in terms of tolerance. In Poland, we're seeing, and it's been the case for some time, the opposite of that, and so you've got a parliament now which has a large amount of support amongst young people, which is quite openly nationalistic in its stances.
Mm. And what about historical factors? You mentioned in your magazine, Business Ukraine, in the Polish special, that you had this Poland-Lithuania Commonwealth. Can you tell us about that, about the historical features of that and how that plays into society today, or even if it does?
Well, I think it's an interesting issue in general, the fact that it's so unknown, or relatively unknown, in historic, in contemporary circles. It's common to refer to Ukraine as a post-Soviet society. It's common to think of Ukraine as a former Russian possession, a colonial possession, or even to an extent a part of Russia. I think this is, you know, there's obviously a lot of truth in that, or that is an important part of Ukraine's inheritance. But for hundreds of years, a large part of today's Ukraine was within the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, which was a very broad state with a lot of different ethnic and religious national groups within it, grouped around the Polish crown. But it was actually, to a significant degree, quite a decentralized state. The 18th century period, we had actually the very end of the Commonwealth period, we had the Polish Constitution, which actually predates most of the major international, the other constitutions internationally, and before that, the Ukrainian Constitution, the Cossack Constitution of 1710, 1711, I believe, which were both very groundbreaking democratic documents for their time and period. And I think they have their roots to an extent in this period of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. If we look at Ukraine as a very diverse country in terms of regional identities, I think that has, to an extent, you know, that can be traced back to the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth religiously as well. The religious diversity, you know, the diverse makeup of Ukraine, the, you know, Armenian, Jewish, certainly Polish, of course, but yeah, certainly Polish, but you know, German, Hungarian, Baltic communities. I think that also was gained a lot of momentum during that time. And cities like Kiev, for a long time after the end of the great partitions of Poland at the end of the 18th century, which wiped Poland off the map as a sovereign state. But for a long time afterwards, Polish was widely spoken in Kiev as Russian is today, and it was a Polish speaking city for a long time. And this is not. The idea that people often think of today is Lviv has a Polish roots. Kiev does too.
Yeah. And well, that was part of our interview with Peter Dickinson, who is the editor of Business Ukraine magazine. And tomorrow we'll upload the full version on our website. It's really interesting. So there's lots of reforms going on. Earlier on, we spoke with the Polish ambassador as well, so we'll upload that onto the website tomorrow. And it's not just reforms in the business environment, but also in the defense sector as well.
That's right. The defense sector has come a long way since the start of the war with combined Russian-backed separatist forces in eastern Ukraine. The country has seen an overhaul in military's logistics, equipment, and even training techniques. However, some setbacks still remain.
And many of these Ukrainian troops who are serving on the front line, they still struggle to get access to basic equipment. Like they have a lot of the military techniques that they need, but actually it really is the small things like the sandbags, the fortifications that they're really struggling with. As you can see on your screen, here's some of the techniques that Ukr Oboronprom showcase. You can see drones. There's also lots of missiles, tanks, that sort of thing.
But I've recently found out that a bit of information from the front line, a Ukrainian war correspondent, Andriy Saplienko, he recently posted on his Facebook a call for ordinary Ukrainians to donate money to buy plastic bags filled with sand. Now, these are used for military fortification to strengthen positions, government-controlled positions, at checkpoints along the front line in eastern Ukraine. Now, he published that it's right now these things are a salvation for our men, and this it will be up to us once again to collect money and to help our guys in the front line.
Yeah, you can see his post on the screen now, but this is just like one of a number of issues that are facing our military.
That's right. A recent RAND report, this is an American nonprofit think tank, and they have published a report where they say they talk about a number of deeply embedded problems within the defense sector. The organization has stressed that if the West provides military equipment or modern weapons, it won't help Ukraine, essentially.
Now, we've done some work to find out how exactly Ukraine's defense sector is reforming. We spoke to a guy named Glenn Grant. Now, he's a former British Army colonel, really interesting guy. We spoke to him earlier on in the week. And currently, he's the project manager of a UK-funded reform project at Ukraine's Ministry of Defense. He's been working closely with top Ukrainian military commanders to help reform the country's defense sector. So, take a look at part of our interview with him now.
In March, you gave quite a critical interview to a Ukrainian TV channel where you stated that you weren't quite happy with the way things were going, what you saw as part of the reform process within the defense ministry. And you talked about the Ukrainian army's military might, like how strong they really are, basically. But since that time, have you noticed any real and meaningful changes since working closely at the MOD?
The answer is yes. But then they are they're more green shoots than major changes. I mean, if you take a sort of a garden picture, there are green shoots all over the place. But there are also some really large weeds that need to be cut out still. And you know, the weeds in some cases are strangling the green shoots. In other cases, the green shoots are growing up are stronger. So it's very hard to say, you know, good and bad. There's still both in places. I mean, a lot of these things are to do with culture and the concepts. We still have the military at the highest level. And a lot of the people in the Ministry of Defence are still working off the old Soviet concepts. They are staying with those purely and simply because they're too frightened to change, because they don't know another one. And so in wartime, they are staying with the familiar. They're holding on to mother's apron as tightly as possible. And that's a problem. So because the reformers are saying you need to change, you need to, for example, delegate responsibility much more to people. But there's still a huge amount of centralisation. If you look at procurement, I mean, the procurement is we are still centralising, you know, the procurement of socks. It's that sort of stupid, you know, everything is going up and being checked. Partially this is to remove corruption, but also partially it's a conceptual thing that this is how we've always done it. Everything gets checked at the centre.
Right, the kind of mentality and the culture surrounding it. For example, the Razumkov Centre recently published an article where it talks about some of the major stumbling blocks of reforms within the Ministry of Defence. And they said that this includes issues of culture and mentality, which are slow to change. Now, obviously, you've just mentioned some of the examples of that. But what steps do you think that should be taken now to overcome these so-called stumbling blocks?
Well, the biggest thing that RAND have said, from the RAND report, is the need to have a civilian Ministry of Defence and a civilian minister. And I would agree with that. I mean, the current minister is doing a lot to actually to create change, but he's still a general. And so that there is not this sort of two-way looking at things that is needed in an organisation where civilians look at at value for money, and the military look at capability and how to kill people better. And then you put the two of them together, and out of it you get the best course. And at the moment we're still in the sort of the military side, and the value for money side hasn't actually caught up. So that we've got the Ministry of Defence with the budget and the money, but the general staff making the plans. And that's a major stumbling block. That was highlighted by Rand as well.
One of their suggestions was to completely overhaul this procurement sector for arms, particularly Ukroboronprom, the state arms manufacturer. They criticize it specifically for its lack of transparency and possible conflict of interest, because they are the country's biggest arms importer. Now, it was created in 2010 by the former disgraced Ukrainian president Viktor Yanukovych, and it's still around, and it's still in charge of over 120 companies. Now, but their mismanagement of the arms industry is basically one of the reasons why, at the start of the war with the Russian-backed insurgent forces in eastern Ukraine, the Ukrainian army was at such a poor level. Their mismanagement.
I mean, it's actually, I think it's even more complex than that. Unfortunately, it is more complex. I mean, I can say that in procurement in general, the Reform Office in the Ministry of Defence have done a brilliant job actually hauling things that were being done outside of the proper routes into the Prezoro system, and actually having competitions for buying things. And that saved a huge amount of money. And they've just started doing it for things like defence housing and contracting as well. Although some of the processes have still got to be improved around that. But that is a major change. But the arms side is being kept very very close inside the general staff and secretive. And they're using, you know, arguments that they believe that we shouldn't tell anybody what we're actually doing. The trouble is that by not telling anybody what you're doing, you're not exposing anything to Parliament, and you're not exposing anything to business, to allow business to say, well, we could do that better.
Open competition.
Open competition, which there are so many arms companies around that would be allowed to do everything from maintenance to producing new things. That you know, open competition is needed, and the defence industry. Again, this is conceptual, because people in the old days thought that the defence industry was part of the Ministry of Defence. And in fact, it actually was. If you go to many Eastern European countries, there are still large parts of their defence industry are owned by the Ministry of Defence. And there's a deputy minister who is effectively the arms man, and they run it, usually extremely inefficiently. I mean, because business is always anything that, you know, twice as good, if not three times as good, as a government managed organisation.
Do you think that there could be any negative outcome of less secrecy and more open business type of approach to procurement of weapons?
I think you've always got to have some degree of secrecy, but it's that degree of secrecy does not mean. Does not mean sort of taking it to the point of absurdity. I mean, it's usual that big weapon procurements, even in wartime, are agreed by Parliament, because Parliament has the say on the money, effectively. And I mean, if you look back at the Second World War or the First World War in Britain, all these things that we were doing were absolutely almost open. You could actually see that they weren't hidden away. You know what we're going to do. I mean, we declared how.
Well, that was just part of our interview, and as I said, we'll upload that to the website later in the week. But joining us now live in the studio is Denis Guriak. Welcome. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you so much for joining us. Denis Guriak is the Deputy Director General of Ukroboronprom, the state arms manufacturer. So a recently published RAND report kind of criticized Ukroboronprom for a lack of transparency and conflict of interest. So basically, the question is, there are still a lot of questions within the Ukroboronprom sector. And do you guys say that weapons procurement is supposed to be secret? But the trouble is with that is that if that's secret, you don't have as much accountability for what your company does to to the public. And so do you think that's fair?
Thank you, first of all, for coming and for the possibility to explain the specifics, actually, of the defense procurement in Ukraine, because that's an opportunity to break some stereotypes, especially for the international audience, especially for the international partners with which we work. First of all, the procurement is done by the MOD or other militarized authorities. We act as our manufacturers, the facilities themselves, sail directly to the militarized authorities, and so that's the first stereotype. Everybody portrays us as an intermediary between the production facility manufacturer and the client. So that's not the fact, and that's first thing. Second thing is that it's not for us to decide whether it should be secret or not. My personal point of view that there should be a transparency and public scrutiny for all things that are logical to be published. You know, there's definitely things that should be kept secret, and that's normal practice worldwide. Mm-hmm. If to speak about imports, which was heavily criticized by Rand, actually a very authoritative and renowned analytical think tank in US, everything what was written there on defense industry is very logical, is very necessary to accomplish. Just two minor corrections on imports. Because we don't act as a procuring agency. We act as procuring agency for the MOD. We don't decide what should be imported or not. This became a practice for the last 2.5 years since the conflict started, only because of the simple fact that there should have been a critical imports in the very beginning of the conflict, and we were the ones who established it. So, yeah.
But you must understand that a lot of Ukrainian taxpayers put their money towards funding the military. Mm-hmm. Sure. So what sort of steps does Oboronprom take to ensure that these figures are open to the public?
Although we are still not obliged by law to put to publish reports, we still do it since the very beginning of the this new management team, of part of which I am, which came in 2014. We're doing it on a half a year basis. As for the reform, we announced a month ago officially launching of corporatization of our enterprises, which means that they would become public companies, shareholding companies, which in its own turn would provide for much more better transparency, which is a clear legal mechanism of for outside investors to work with us and to have us to view us as a reliable partner. Yeah.
Do you find that foreign investors are actually interested in cooperating with Oboronprom, or are they actually put off by all this Ukrainian legislation and red tape that they have to go through?
Yeah, we are on a day-to-day basis actively lobbying for changes of legislation. We had ourselves launched 12 or 15 draft laws through the government to the parliament. For changing and reforming and doing necessary steps that are which we require desperately even yesterday. You know the complexity of Ukrainian decision-making process and the legal system, if to speak diplomatically. And for people like
difficult.
Me, it's kind of frustrating working in the system and explaining to everybody some obvious things that should be done.
Of course. There's been a lot of talk over the authority within Oboronprom. So can we ask you, how much authority does Ukraine's president, Petro Poroshenko, currently have over Oboronprom?
He appoints the director general of Oboronprom according to the law, which was adopted in 2011.
So it seems that Rand's suggestions were they quoted as saying that there are ambiguities and divisions within the defense sector, and this includes the kind of managing and authority, that there's no clear difference between who's in charge, the cabinet ministers or Poroshenko, basically.
Is that a fair assessment?
They slight they slightly touched this issue, and the idea of the reform actually is one of the thing, one of the issues in the reform strategy which we presented is also clear division of responsibilities, because for us it's also an issue. It's an internal management issue, internally governmental management issue. And actually in their report, RAND touched heavily on the subject that there is a lack of coordination between agencies in Ukraine, and my day-to-day job, I agree with this completely, and that's the first thing which we need to desperately solve. So that's what is my main aspiration as a first thing to do. Secondly, what needs to be done is, I already touched about it, is elimination of some stereotypes.
So you think your company gets a lot of like false reports?
Well, I understand why is it happening. Is because Ukraine originally had a reputation of a gray armament dealer on a worldwide market due to objective things that happened actually for 25 years since Ukraine independence, which was selling off the military stock.
Right. Which Ukraine has always been like one of the top arms exporters.
But and it still is.
Exactly. But where does the money go now? From the sales
of all these exports. I mean, is it publicly available again?
We for last 2 years, according to our 2 year report, which was published in July 2016, we paid more than 8 billion UA hryvnia in salaries. We paid a lot of taxes, if I'm not mistaken. This is the percentage of the taxes that we pay is around 30% of the general revenue. So it's a very big
indicator. It's a lot
indicator.
Of money. Then.
Yeah, it's a lot of money. We pay a lot of taxes. We have very small margins from revenue margins from our internal customers, the MOD, National Guard, etc. Yeah. So the most margin we get from export, which is a clear strategy of protection of national interest.
Perfect. Well, Mr. Gorak, thank you very much for coming on the show. And that's all for the show this evening. Remember, you can go to our website again and Facebook again and watch the show. We've had some really interesting guests on this evening. And also, you can sign up for our Facebook and Twitter pages as well. So that's all from us. Good night.
See you next week.